Thank you for joining us today. We trust that you will be motivated, challenged, and inspired by this week's message. Let's join Mike now.
I've noticed in life that people are sometimes so desperate to have what someone else has that they will go to any lengths to do what they do. Almost a quarter of all UK residents have been victims of identity fraud, and we are more at risk of having our identities stolen than any other nation in Europe. They will even deceive to get others to believe so they can receive. Who am I talking about? I could be talking about us, but I'm talking about people who will go to any lengths. They will deceive to get others to believe so they can receive. Can I tell you, this also goes on in church life. So the issue stems right back to birth. Most people who have an identity crisis can trace it back to upbringing and childhood, and many times sibling rivalry. It starts young. Little ones start establishing their identity from a real early age, but are constantly impressionable and consequently copy what they see. We were with the kids in the atrium last Sunday after the experience, and we were watching as the kids were playing with each other and running all over the place. Some of the older ones were running and shouting, and you guessed it, it wasn't even milliseconds later when some of the real young ones copied what they did. Why did they do it? Well, essentially, not only to copy, but to get the attention of the watching adults, because we were laughing so much. And so the volume just went up and up and up. I'm going to be louder than he was and she was, so that I can grab the attention that they currently have. I think I might have just touched upon something, because there's another reason why people often end up a copy, because the copy seems to be getting more attention than me as an original. You ever been with people in a conversation and there's one person that always has to be the loudest? I might be talking about you right now, but I don't know that to be true. So I'm just acting dumb right now. If I do know it to be true, I'm not aiming it at you. I'm just saying. You know what I mean. There's always one. And they get louder and they jump in a conversation before someone else can finish one sentence. They're in on something else because they're vying for attention. What does that tell you? They're not really confident about who they are, because they're threatened about the person that's louder than them in the conversation. So it's like, I need to get my opinion across. You don't know my opinion. Let me speak. That in some ways was the problem for Jacob, because Isaac, as we know, favored Esau over Jacob. And we could so easily kind of give Jacob a hard time today, and I'm going to balance it, because even though he wanted a different identity, Esau's position wasn't good either, by really kind of throwing away his identity. He didn't care about his identity. And I hear you say, well, why is that a problem? Surely, out of the two, it's better to be like that than to always want another identity. Well, I'm not so sure. Because when we lose interest in who we are, we'll lose the influence of what we could become. We'll lose everything that God has planned for us if we are not who we should be. So when you aren't really worried about who you are, it's almost as bad as trying to steal someone else's identity, because you're so relaxed about being you that it's actually not doing you any favors, because essentially you don't care who you are. And God wants us to be who we've been created to be, because he needs us to become what we've been called to become. There's a become ahead of us. We haven't yet become everything that God's called us to become. Maybe because we haven't yet been who we've been called to be. We haven't yet settled everything. We're happy with 50% of who we are, but there's 50% that's a work in progress. There's things that still we are not settled with. There are still things that we have issues about. There are still things that we haven't got over. There are still things we haven't yet accepted about who we are. Am I speaking to anybody that this might be relevant to today? Let me ask you something. How many times in life have you got frustrated because things haven't worked out the way you wanted despite trying multiple times? And you couldn't understand, and maybe still don't even understand to this day, because you've heard all the faith preaching that you can stomach that tells you that if at first you don't succeed, try again, and no one's tried more than you've tried. You faithed it time and time and time again. And you put into practice what the preacher said. How if you want to triumph, you have to put more oomph in your try. Right? And no one's tried harder than you. And you've spoken to your circumstances. You've shouted at your circumstances. You've even screamed at your circumstances in Jesus' name. And you don't know what else to say and what else to do because nothing changed. I don't think I have honest people in the house today. Some of you acting like this is only applicable to me. I want to tell you, I've screamed, I've shouted, I've said in Jesus' name more than anybody's name, and it still hasn't happened. I want to show you something really powerful here that God showed me, and it's so simple that we've missed it. The reason you've potentially been unable to do what you've tried to do is because you're trying to be someone you're not enabled to be. And as a result, you've disabled yourself. So when we're trying to be someone that we've not been created to be, it isn't just that we're wasting our time and things won't work out, but actually it disables who we're meant to be, because we're putting so much time and effort into trying to be someone else that time and effort is no longer being put into who we need to be. So we disable ourselves. And rather than progress, we have to get back to square one again to start walking. So in other words, you haven't faithed it throughout those times. When you shouted, you blame the devil, you've cursed, you've prayed in faith. You haven't faithed it, you faked it. See, our success comes from being the best me we can be. Everything is connected to being who we are created to be, the true original. And no one else can be the best you. Only you can. Let me show you something. I love using props in my messages. Have you noticed that recently? I want to show you something. I shared last week that when we walk in someone else's shoes, we discover pretty quickly that their shoes don't fit. So I want to illustrate something here. I should have worn easier shoes to take off, but hey. So I'm taking off my shoes because I don't like my shoes, so I'm going to walk in someone else's shoes. And I'm going to try walking in someone else's shoes. Do you like them? I mean, look at them. These shoes were never meant to fit. Because someone else's shoes are for their feet, for their walk, down their path, on their journey. Our shoes will fit our feet and take us where we need to go so that we can do what we've been called to do by being who we've been created to be. See, the problem is, someone else's shoes will either be too big. I mean, look. It's hilarious. These are size 14s. It's the biggest shoe I could find. Size 14. I mean, who's got size 14 feet? If anybody has, these are yours after, because I don't want to take them back to the shop. Anybody got size 14s, you're welcome to them. But listen, I mean, they're humongous. They're like a giant's feet. I take a size 8, pretty standard size. And when I put my foot in the shoe, once I can get it in there, it fits. Wow, isn't that amazing? You see, the problem is with someone else's shoes, they don't fit. They're either too big or too small. And however much I try, I am not going to be able to make these fit. What will happen, and I was thinking of experimenting, but I'm not sure I want to end up in A&E. What would happen if I was to run across the stage now in shoes that don't fit me? I tell you what would happen, I'd trip up, because I trip up in my own flip-flops that do fit me, but let alone these things that are falling off the back of my feet. Why? Because they weren't meant for me. Pretty soon, if we're wearing someone else's shoes, it won't be that they just don't fit, they will hurt. And it's not only that we want to be in someone else's shoes, because if we truly knew what it was really like being in their shoes, we would realize it's not actually all it's cracked up to be. What we think we want is to walk down their path and to be on their journey. Despite what they say, you can't put yourself in someone else's shoes because they don't fit you. We've got to quit trying different pairs of shoes on in life. Pairs of shoes that don't fit, these are no good whatsoever to me. These are, but these would be no good to the person who's going to wear those, because they won't even get them on. Nowhere near. See, these are for me. And you know, there's something else. If that's your style of shoe, good on you. But it's not mine. So it's not only that it's not the right size, it's not my style. Don't we all just go into shops and choose our style? And the style that suits us? So when we're trying to walk in someone else's shoes, sometimes it's not just about the fact it's too big or too small. And I was thinking about that. When you walk in someone else's shoes that are too small, you don't live the life that God has for you that's so much bigger. And sometimes you're trying to walk in bigger shoes than your life is capable of walking in. And that's okay to accept that it's wrong. It's okay to say, do you know what? Those shoes are too big. How many times have we switched our televisions on? It's coming around again, I believe, because I've seen the adverts. The X Factor is coming on again. And we're going to see people trying to wear shoes that are too big, singing songs that are too, what's the saying that they say? That song was too big for you. What that means is you have a voice. Well, some of them do. You have a voice. Some we know shouldn't even be on the show, but they make the entertainment. But you have a voice. It's just, it's not quite as good as you think. And it may well be that you've reached your capacity and you can't go any further. And you know that's okay. Because you weren't meant to go down the road of Celine Dion. You were not meant to go down the road of Mariah Carey. You were not meant to go down the road of some of the other guys that have gone through the X Factor. It's not your journey. It's not the path that you're on. So we got to quit trying these shoes all the time. See, our shoes will be perfect for the path we need to tread and the walk we need to take. So what am I really trying to say? I'm trying to bring it to a point of saying, listen, be yourself. Be the original God created you to be rather than the copy you may have become. Last week I said, why would you want to be a second-class copy when you can be a first-class original? You were born an original, so don't die a copy. Amen. Come on, let's stand and give God a big hand clap for his word today. Amen. You know, we never end our service without giving people an opportunity to come to Jesus. We know that there were, all the figures roll into one in the end, but you know, we've gone over 6,000 now in Pakistan, and I think it was several hundred got saved this week from memory. I get so many emails of good things that are going on out there that I don't retain all the information, but great things happening in Pakistan where people are praying a prayer like we're offering right now for people to pray, and their lives are being transformed. And you need to pray for these people in Pakistan for their protection, because you know, not very far away from them are people going through difficult circumstances for giving their lives to Jesus Christ. So you might be watching online today, and I want to just encourage you to pray a prayer. But I really believe, even though there will be words in this prayer, that we're going to encourage people to pray if they don't know Jesus, this prayer could be used for you today to accept your identity, to accept who you are in Christ. And even though you might pray words like, you know, this is the first step I'm going to take, and you might think, well, this isn't the first step I'm going to take, but it could be the first step you're going to take of accepting your identity. Maybe you've walked the Christian path, but you've been walking in someone else's path. You've had someone else's shoes on. You've been on a road or a walkway that isn't for you. And now you're going to take your first steps wearing your shoes that fit rather than these. Look, I can even get my shoes in these shoes. They are so big. Look at that. I managed to do it, but it's not comfortable, and it will hurt eventually. Come on, let's help these people that are going to pray this prayer, both online and in the building today, and just pray these words if you don't know Jesus, or even if you do, and you really want to start this journey anew. Say this with me. Lord, today I want to thank you that I am unique in every way. Help me to accept who I am so that I can be who you've created me to be in order to become what you've called me to become. From here on, I'm going to quit trying on different pairs of shoes that don't fit me and put on the shoes that you've made for me that are a perfect fit for the path I need to tread and the walk I need to take. Today, I accept you, Jesus, into my life. I'm sorry for my past and thankful for my future, as today I take my first step in faith through your grace and because of your love. In Jesus' name, amen.
We hope you have enjoyed today's message. To download further resources, click on the resources icon. If this message has impacted your life, we would love to hear from you. So don't forget to join us next week for another inspiring message.